mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Petitioners against the presidential bid of Ferdinand Marcos Jr. raised concerns over alleged interference on the disqualification cases. COMELEC Commissioner Rowena Guanzon mentioned one name, former Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Sal Panelo. He will join us later on in the program. Meanwhile, Marcos's political party wants Commissioner Guanzon punished for leaking details on the matter. The Philippines again and slides to last place in Bloomberg's COVID Resilience Index. And more provinces placed under COVID Alert Level 3. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Hey, thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. Topping the news this hour, outgoing Election Commissioner Rowena Guanzon reveals she voted to disqualify the late dictator's son, Ferdinand Marcos Jr., from the presidential race. Guanzon adds, the much-anticipated decision of the poll body's first division on the case is under pressure from external forces. Inara Firmina reports.
The COMELEC First Division has yet to vote on three consolidated petitions seeking to disqualify presidential contender Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. But the division's presiding officer and most senior commissioner, Rowena Guanzon, is already making public her vote in favor of the petitioners.
So your vote was to disqualify Bongbong Marcos, tama po ko?
Yes, kasi who is has the duty to write the resolution, 16 days na, hindi pa niya nilalabas eh. May agreement naman kami na January 17 nilabas. So January 17, di niya nilabas. Ako, nilabas ko yung voto ko in a separate opinion. The separate opinion is a separate written vote of any commissioner. Separate from the resolution.
The petitions were separately filed by martial law survivors led by Bonifacio Ilagan, Akbayan Citizens Action Party, and Abubakar Mangelen, Commissioner of the National Commission on Muslim Filipinos and former chairman of Marcos's political party, Partido Federal ng Pilipinas. Guanzon, who retires on Wednesday, February 2, believes Marcos has been sentenced to a crime involving moral turpitude, which is one of the grounds for disqualification under the Omnibus Election Code.
The issue is Section 12 of the Omnibus Election Code. And the issue is their moral turpitude. When he did that file his income tax return for 4 years as governor of Ilocos Norte, I found that there is moral turpitude. Why? He did not only not file his income tax and pay his income tax once, but 4 times. And he was governor. He was not an ordinary citizen. Furthermore, when the court of appeals convicted him, although there was no imprisonment, there was a fine, his lawyer admitted during the hearing that they did not pay the fine in the regional trial court.
Like the upper-level courts, the COMELEC keeps confidential the identity of the ponente or commissioner in charge of a particular case, who is tasked to write the draft ruling or ponencia. But Guanzon is naming Commissioner Amy Ferrolino as the ponente in this case.
The other commissioner, Commissioner Casquejo, already tried to reach also Commissioner Ferrolino. But she was not answering.
The poll body earlier announced one of the ponente's lawyers contracted COVID-19. To explain why the January 17 target release of the resolution was not met, Guanzon suspects an unseen hand interfering in the case. The commissioner says she cannot determine the fate of her vote, whether it will be counted or set aside, if the division still does not set the voting prior to her retirement.
Ibig sabihin may naging political interference. Kasi obvious ba, hindi naman siya sumasagot na ng telepono niya. Ayaw niya talaga sumagot. No. Bakit ba ayaw sumagot? Eh, talo o panalo si Bongbong Marcos dito. Mag-motion for reconsideration din naman sila eh. Tumungin niya na lang si Secretary Salpanelo as spokesman eh. Anong comment niya dito?
Commissioner Ferolino refuses to comment for now, citing the sub judice rule. Guanzon, who is applying for deputy ombudsman for the Visayas, stresses it is in the best interest of all parties for this case to be expeditiously resolved so that it can be elevated to the Supreme Court.
It's going to have consequences. What if they are DQ'd in the Supreme Court after the election? What's going to happen? He cannot assume office.
Marcos's name is included in the ballot, which has already started printing since the 20th. Since this consolidated case and four other separate cases against his Malacañang bid have not yet attained finality. Ina Reformina, ABS-CBN News.
Ang ating chief presidential legal
The political party of presidentialist Byron Ferdinand Marcos Jr. wants poll commissioner Rowena Guanzon disbarred and her retirement benefits forfeited. Partido Federal ng Pilipinas General Counsel Attorney George Briones blames Guanzon for what he described as the illegal leaking of her decision on the Marcos disqualification case. He points out no decision has been promulgated yet by the COMELEC First Division. Briones also called out Guanzon for implying double hearsay. He also calls on the COMELEC Unbanked to conduct an administrative investigation. But Guanzon is unfazed. She challenges Briones to engage her in a debate on TV. Guanzon maintains she's standing for transparency, and timely government service for all Filipinos. We're going to take a break now. Up ahead, the Philippines back at the bottom of Bloomberg's COVID-19 resilience ranking. Details of that story and more when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And
we're back. You're still with Dateline Philippines here on AMC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. Petitioners against the presidential bid of Ferdinand Marcos Jr. raise concerns over alleged interference on the disqualification cases. Meanwhile, Marcos's political party wants Comelec Commissioner Rowena Guanzon punished for leaking details on the matter. The Philippines again slides to last place in Bloomberg's COVID Resilience Index. Plus, more provinces placed under COVID alert level 3. While Commissioner Guanzon did not identify who or where the interference in the Marcos case is coming from, she told our correspondent Ina Reformina to speak to former Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Sal Panelo about it. In a statement, Panelo said President Duterte has never interfered with the functions of the constitutional bodies. Attorney Panelo now joins us here on the program. Attorney Panelo, good afternoon to you. Welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us today.
Good afternoon, Armenia. Good afternoon.
All right, first question. What do you know about this political interference that Commissioner Guanzon is talking about?
Well, first, let me say that I do not know whether or not Commissioner Guanzon told you about our conversation. Number one, that particular statement of Commissioner Guanzon is alarming in the sense that there appears to be some interference coming from, she has not identified the person. But regardless of who that may be, I think that's alarming because this is a constitutional body and nobody should interfere, persuade, coerce, influence, or pressure any member of the commission on election to resolve the disqualification case one way or the other. My position at the inception of this petition is very clear. I said then, and I'm saying it now, that it is unfair for Senator Ferdinand Marcos Jr., as well as the petitioner and the electorate, for Comelec not to resolve this case immediately. This is a very simple case of a legal issue arising from a previous conviction of the former senator. Now, it does not require any documentary evidence or testimonial evidence, except only with respect to the law concerned. The issue is very simple, Carmina. Is he the disqualified under the law. The issue is, was there a conviction? And if there is a conviction, is the accessory penalty includes perpetual disqualification from office? Hmm. And that will apply only if the crime convicted or the crime involved involves moral torpedo.
Okay, attorney. Yeah, I'm sorry to cut you there, Attorney Panalo. But now that we have this situation, wherein if you believe Commissioner Guanzon, the decision is being held hostage by Commissioner Ferolino, what can you say about that? That there is now a delay in making the decision public because Commissioner Ferolino is nowhere to be found. She seems to be missing in action. If you believe Commissioner Guanzon.
As I said, there is no reason, no sane reason for a delay in the resolution of this case. It is outrageous for anyone to interfere. The president of this country has never interfered in any constitutional body. In fact, this president has never even interfered with the departments of his own departments.
If that is the case, Attorney Panalo, do you have reason to believe that whoever this influential politician is that he or she is acting on his or her own?
Definitely, because the president will never allow nor tolerate anyone using his name or making it appear that he or she is under the instruction of this president.
Do you know who this influential politician is, Attorney Panalo?
Commissioner Guanzon has to identify that politician.
You say that Commissioner Guanzon as well should be left alone. But now yeah. We're hearing from Attorney George Briones of Partido Federal saying that he is now calling on the COMELEC to investigate the commissioner, even calling on her to get disbarred. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, that is for the particular agency or court to decide. I will not intrude into that. That is another legal issue that will be resolved. So I'd rather not say anything about it. Attorney George Briones has the right to say whatever he's saying now because he is supposed to be representing the former senator.
Tell me something, Attorney Panalo. Was it right for Commissioner Guanzon to reveal her vote pending the resolution of the matter?
We have to ask Commissioner Guanzon, what's the purpose for revealing her statement? I cannot fathom as of this time her rationale for doing so. There must be a reason for doing that.
But do you think it serves the purpose of the electorate? Or even both sides, that she revealed her vote on the matter?
I don't know about that. What I want is that this case must be resolved immediately, as in immediately even today. There is no reason for them to delay it. If they have already made the decision, then out with it.
Mm. Attorney Sal, do you think that Commissioner Guanzon should be disbarred because of this?
Again, that is not mine to decide. That is a legal issue, and we will have to let the particular agency or court to decide on that.
You said a while ago that Commissioner Guanzon should reveal the identity of this influential politician. You also said that the president, in so many words, does not condone any such action. That he has been against any interference from the very beginning. But knowing that now that there is interference that's happening, if you believe Commissioner Guanzon, what is your message to that politician, that influential politician who has been meddling with the case, Attorney Panalo?
Well, my message to all, and that includes everybody, regardless of their political affiliation, we have to abide by the rule of law, due process. We have to wait for this decision to come out. We cannot be interfering, we cannot be intruding, we cannot be persuading, pressuring, or whatever, any kind of action that will put the commissioners to decide one way or the other. Let us respect the law. What the law says, as the president says, Let the law take its course.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Attorney Sal Panelo, former Chief Presidential Legal Counsel of President Duterte. Thank you, Attorney Panelo, for joining us today. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Bob, for having me.
And next week on In Focus, former defense, former national security advisor Norberto Gonzalez speaks to us about his presidential candidacy. Mr. Gonzalez will be with us on Tuesday, February 1st, here on Dateline Philippines. If you have any questions, send them in to ANC Alerts on Twitter and ANC20 and on Facebook. Use the hashtag ANC In Focus. The Philippines again lands at the bottom of Bloomberg's COVID Resilience Index for January 2022. After rising to the 50th spot in December, the country again found itself dead last in a list of 53 nations ranked according to how effectively they are handling the virus. Bloomberg notes vaccine coverage has played a factor in the latest index, as previous supply issues for developing countries have evolved into a logistical challenge of reaching people in rural areas. More areas in the Philippines placed under the country's third highest COVID alert level. These are the provinces of Palawan, Camiguin, Davao Occidental, Dinagat Islands, Tawi-Tawi, and Sulu. The new alert level will be in effect from Friday until February 15th. The Philippines logged more than 18,000 new COVID cases Thursday. This brings the total to nearly 3.5 million. Active cases stand at 226,000. The Octo Research Group points out five cities in the National Capital Region have now become moderate risks for COVID-19 transmission. These are Caloocan, Navotas, Malabon, Valenzuela, and Manila. For the UP Pandemic Response Team, the improving numbers in NCR means government can now shift its focus and resources to the Philippines.
Kasi marami sa mga provinces, less vaccination coverage at less ang healthcare capacity. For the Cordillera itself sa region, medyo tumaas yung ating ICU occupancy. Kailangan itong tutukan din yung Region 5. Talagang nag-increase po ang ICU occupancy sa Region 5. At isa sa mga kailangan tingnan din natin yung sa Mindanao.
COVID-19 cases in the Calabarzon region also going down. Our very own Michael DeLiso now joins us with that story. Michael, go ahead.
That's right, Carmina. New COVID-19 cases in the Calabarzon region, or Region 4A, that's south of Metro Manila, are on a downward trend according to a report from independent research group OCTA. In an analysis on the data released by the Department of Health on Thursday, OCTA saw a negative growth rate in Cavite and Laguna, which are both -48%, Batangas, -41%, Quezon, -18%, and Rizal, -61%. However, these provinces are still considered high risk for COVID-19, except for Rizal, which is in moderate due to the high average daily attack rate. Meanwhile, the reproduction numbers in Rizal and Cavite are low, while it's moderate in Batangas and Laguna, and high in Quezon. The healthcare utilization rate in the region is low, apart from Quezon, where more than half of COVID beds are occupied and is classified as moderate. All provinces in the region still have high positivity rates ranging from 28% to 45%. As of Thursday, the active cases in the region are over 30,000. DOH Calabarzon Regional Director Dr. Ariel Valencia said, "It is still early to say if there is already a downward trend because the decline was not consistent." He said, though, that the utilization of COVID beds are relatively low and has not reached critical level. Based on history, Valencia noted that Calabarzon was just following the trend in Metro Manila because many workers in the capital region are also from Calabarzon. As of Thursday, Metro Manila has a negative 67% growth rate and 32% utilization in hospitals, which is considered low. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Michael DeLiso. So they are joining us on the line. One of the officials leading the Philippines' pandemic response admits government is still struggling with its contact tracing efforts. Contact tracing Chief Benjamin Magalong says identifying people exposed to infected individuals became more challenging after the contracts of thousands of contact tracers expired. But Magalong says local government units are still doing everything they can to ramp up efforts.
Ang advice ko sa DILG team is for contact tracers to just focus on the first level generation. Huwag nang umabot pa sa second level. Talagang na-overwhelm na ang ating mga contact tracers. Pero nitong tinamaan tayo ng Omicron, talagang ang isang contact tracer ang hinahawakan niya, mga 30, 40 cases. And it's very, very impossible for him to be able to process all these patients. Kasi ang isang contact tracer to conduct a quality contact tracing, dapat mga 4 or 5 patients lang ang pwede niyang i-process every day. And can you just imagine yung challenge to process 30 to 40 patients a day? That is impossible, very, very impossible. Kaya talagang yun na lang ang concentration namin. Go for the first gen level generation and maximize mo na lang yung activities mo for that day.
Majority of Filipinos willing to get a COVID-19 booster shot. That's according to the latest SWS survey, which shows 4 out of 5 or 80% of adult Filipinos are okay with getting an additional dose of the vaccine. 7% are unwilling, while 13% are unsure. The study was conducted from December 12 to 16 last year with over 1,400 respondents. The same survey showed only 8% of adult Filipinos are unwilling to get vaccinated against the coronavirus, 10 percentage points lower than September's 18%. The UK already one step ahead of a pandemic exit after a relatively brief return to coronavirus restrictions triggered by the Omicron surge. England is reviving its plan A, learning to live with a disease that is probably here to stay. Here's what that looks like.
England returned to its so-called plan A on Thursday, learning to live with COVID, a disease that is probably here to stay. Mask mandates and COVID passes lapsed, and work-from-home guidance ended last week. The bet is that a combination of booster jab, antiviral pills, and Omicron's lower severity will enable the government to manage outbreaks of a virus that cannot be shut out. Now the UK Health Security Agency is preparing to switch the focus to supporting vulnerable individuals, rather than imposing national rules, according to a draft policy seen by Reuters. Graham Medley, chair of the government's COVID modelling group, said when tougher measures were introduced in December, the severity of Omicron and the impact of boosters had been unclear.
As the amount of immunity develops in the population, so each future wave becomes less of a problem for government. However, I think the other thing that we can be pretty sure about is that there will be steps backwards.
The relentless focus on managing COVID rather than preventing infections can also have unwanted side effects. With the National Health Service resources diverted towards vaccination boosters, thousands of other appointments have been postponed, adding to a vast backlog of elective care in the state-run system. At the same time, high infection rates among staff and patients continue to weigh heavily on hospitals.
The Met is now investigating.
As police investigate gatherings held at Prime Minister Johnson's office during COVID lockdowns, in apparent violation of laws he had himself imposed, and with many of his own lawmakers determined that he must return life to near normal, Johnson has a strong political imperative to lift restrictions. Other countries equally keen to unshackle business and personal freedom will be watching.
India's capital, New Delhi, is ending its weekend curfew and easing other COVID restrictions. Restaurants are also allowed to reopen, and markets can now operate at full capacity. Latest data suggests. The country's recent Omicron outbreak has slowed. India recorded 285,000 new cases in the past day, down substantially from the figures seen a week earlier. Sweden decides against recommending COVID vaccines for kids aged 5 to 11. The country's health agency believes the benefits of vaccination do not outweigh the risks, since current data show low risk for serious disease among young children. But it adds the decision could be revisited if the research changes or if a new variant changes the pandemic situation. Sweden registered more than 40,000 new cases on Wednesday, one of the highest daily tallies during the pandemic. The European Union's drug regulator greenlights Pfizer's antiviral COVID-19 pill for high-risk patients. This comes as the region scrambles to boost its arsenal to fight the Omicron variant. The conditional approval of Paxlovid paves the way for EU member states to deploy the drug after the regulator gave guidance for its emergency use late last year. Italy, Germany, and Belgium are among the handful of European countries that have bought the drug. Israel says protesters against COVID-19 measures who liken themselves to Jews under Nazi persecution are fueling global anti-Semitism. More in this report.
A sign held by a New York anti-vax protester shows syringes arranged as a swastika. Protesters against COVID-19 measures who liken themselves to Jews under Nazi persecution, like this woman wearing a yellow star in Rome, are fostering anti-Semitism, according to the Israeli government in a report marking International Holocaust Remembrance Day. Such tropes have become widespread, the Diaspora Affairs Ministry found. Dani Dayan chairs Israel's Yad Vashem Holocaust Memorial Museum.
We see two things that we should be very clear in combating them. One is Holocaust distortion and the other is Holocaust trivialization. The COVID brought Holocaust trivialization to a summit. Those comparisons between green passes to the yellow star, comparing Dr. Fauci to Mengele and things like that, sometimes done by politicians, by public figures, are despicable.
Several US and British politicians have apologized for suggesting vaccine or closure policies recalled Hitler's regime. Former Israeli chief rabbi Israel Meilal survived a concentration camp as a child. His parents and brother were among the 6 million Jews killed by the Nazis.
How can you compare it to a disease or to an economic problem or political problem? Nothing to compare. Please leave the word Holocaust for the Holocaust and nothing but it.
Such displays showed factual knowledge of the genocide was eroding, the report said. It added that some COVID-19 agitators have been consuming and disseminating anti-Semitic conspiracy theories that say Jews are responsible for the crisis.
We're going to take a break now. Still ahead, the NBA names the captains of its All-Star game this year. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us here on ANC.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
News now, Honduras makes history as it swears in its first female president. Thousands packed a soccer stadium in the country's capital to witness the inauguration of President Xiomara Castro. This marks the end of the eight-year rule of Juan Orlando Hernandez, which is marred by corruption and economic downturn, leaving behind a debt of over $15 billion. Castro vowed to fix the country's unparalleled economic crisis and revealed her plan to establish an anti-corruption commission. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris attended the event. Harris promised to collaborate on migration issues, economic development, and the fight against impunity. Russia claims it is clear the U.S. is not willing to address its main security concerns in their standoff over Ukraine. Here's the full story.
One day after the U.S. hand-delivered a response to Russia regarding its security concerns, Moscow on Thursday said it was clear the U.S. was not willing to address the most critical among them. As delicate negotiations continue, Russia remains steadfast in its demand that post-Cold War security arrangements in Europe be redrawn. Specifically, Russia is insisting that NATO halt any further enlargement, bar Ukraine from ever joining the alliance, and pull back forces and weaponry from Eastern European countries that entered NATO after the Cold War. Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov doubled down on Moscow's position Thursday.
As for the main question, there is no positive reaction to it in the document. The main question is our clear message that we consider further NATO expansion to the east and weapons deployment, which can threaten the Russian Federation, unacceptable.
But a day earlier, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken, while not disclosing the specifics of the U.S. response, made it clear that blocking the expansion of NATO was a non-starter.
NATO's door is open, remains open, and that is our commitment.
Meanwhile, Russia has continued military drills near its border with Ukraine, where it has massed some 100,000 troops, provoking Western fears of an invasion. Kremlin spokesman Dmitry Peskov on Thursday said Moscow needed time to review the U.S. document, as well as one submitted by NATO, and would not rush to conclusions, but that the responses to Russia's key demands did not leave much room for optimism. The U.S. on Thursday called on China to use its influence with Russia to urge a diplomatic solution to the crisis, but policy experts doubted Beijing would back Washington in the standoff.
Staffers of the World Health Organization in the Western Pacific accused their top boss of racism and abuse. According to a report by the South China Morning Post, the allegations were laid out in an internal complaint against Dr. Takeshi Kasai, the director of the Global Bodies Regional Office. The complaint described a, quote, toxic atmosphere with a culture of systemic bullying and public ridiculing at the division's headquarters in Manila. There were also recordings where Kasai was heard making racist comments on an employee. In an email to the media, Kasai denied the allegations. He, however, committed to make changes to ensure a positive work environment. In business, the European Union files a case against China at the World Trade Organization for targeting Lithuania over its stance on Taiwan. EU leaders say Beijing's allegedly discriminatory trade practices were harming exporters in Lithuania and elsewhere in the bloc. China has downgraded diplomatic ties with Lithuania and pressured multinationals to sever links with the Baltic state after it allowed Taiwan to open a de facto embassy in Vilnius.
These measures are a threat to the integrity of the EU single market. Since December 1st, Chinese customs are banning Lithuanian imports from the Chinese market. The most affected sectors are pharmaceuticals, lasers, electronics, and food. Chinese companies are cancelling orders from Lithuania. China is also cutting its exports to Lithuania. Moreover, China is putting pressure on international companies to abandon the use of Lithuanian components in their production, otherwise they may face import restrictions. In fact, China's own customs statistics reports a 91% drop of trade from Lithuania to China in December 2021 to compare with December 2020.
The China's foreign ministry insists its issue with Lithuania was political and not economic. It adds Beijing has acted in accordance with WTO rules. Over in Argentina, hundreds took to the streets of Buenos Aires to urge the government there not to pay its debt to the International Monetary Fund. Argentina is facing deadlines for over $1 billion in debt repayments to the IMF by Tuesday. But officials of the country, which has been battling currency and debt crises for years, have not confirmed plans to pay. It maintains tense negotiations with a multilateral lender to renegotiate a loan for about $40 billion. Many blame the IMF for austerity measures, make that austerity measures that worsened a major economic crisis in 2001 to 2002, which plunged scores of Argentines into poverty. Let's take another look at our headlines this hour. Outgoing election commissioner Rowena Guanzon reveals she voted to disqualify the late dictator's son, Ferdinand Marcos Jr., from the presidential race. Guanzon adds the much-anticipated decision of the poll body's first division on the case is under pressure from external forces. Ina Reformina reports.
The COMELEC First Division has yet to vote on three consolidated petitions seeking to disqualify presidential contender Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. But the division's presiding officer and most senior commissioner, Rowena Guanzon, is already making public her vote in favor of the petitioners.
So your vote was to disqualify Bongbong Marcos, tama po ko?
Yes, kasi Presidente, who is has the duty to write the resolution, 16 days na, hindi pa niya nilalabas eh. Eh, may agreement naman kami na January 17 nilabas. So, January 17, hindi niya nilabas. Ako, nilabas ko yung voto ko in a separate opinion. The separate opinion is a separate written vote of any commissioner. Separate from the resolution.
The petitions were separately filed by martial law survivors led by Bonifacio Ilagan, Akbayan Citizens Action Party, and Abubakar Mangelen, Commissioner of the National Commission on Muslim Filipinos and former chairman of Marcos's political party, Partido Federal ng Pilipinas. Guanzon, who retires on Wednesday, February 2, believes Marcos has been sentenced to a crime involving moral turpitude, which is one of the grounds for disqualification under the Omnibus Election Code.
The issue is Section 12 of the Omnibus Election Code. And the issue is their moral turpitude. When he did not file his income tax return for 4 years as governor of Ilocos Norte, I found that there is moral turpitude. Why? He did not only not file his income tax and pay his income tax once, but 4 times. And he was governor. He was not an ordinary citizen. Furthermore, when the Court of Appeals convicted him, although there was no imprisonment, there was a fine, His lawyer admitted during the hearing that they did not pay the fine in the regional trial court.
Like the upper-level courts, the COMELEC keeps confidential the identity of the ponente or commissioner in charge of a particular case, who is tasked to write the draft ruling or ponencia. But Guanzon is naming Commissioner Amy Ferolino as the ponente in this case.
The other commissioner, Commissioner Casquejo, already tried to reach also Commissioner Ferolino. But she was not answering.
The poll body earlier announced one of the ponente's lawyers contracted COVID-19 to explain why the January 17 target release of the resolution was not met. Guanzon suspects an unseen hand interfering in the case. The commissioner says she cannot determine the fate of her vote, whether it will be counted or set aside, if the division still does not set the voting prior to her retirement.
Ibig sabihin may naging political interference. Kasi obvious ba, hindi naman siya sumasagot na ng telepono niya. Ayaw niya talaga sumagot. Oo. Bakit ba ayaw sumagot? Talo o panalo si Bongbong Marcos dito. Mag-motion for reconsideration din naman sila eh. Tumungin niya na lang si Secretary Salpanelo as spokesman eh. Anong comment niya dito?
Commissioner Ferolino refuses to comment for now, citing the sub judice rule. Guanzon, who is applying for deputy ombudsman for the Visayas, stresses it is in the best interest of all parties for this case to be expeditiously resolved so that it can be elevated to the Supreme Court.
It's going to have consequences. What if they are DQ'd in the Supreme Court after the election? What's going to happen? He cannot assume office.
Marcos's name is included in the ballot, which has already started printing since the 20th. Since this consolidated case and four other separate cases against his Malacanang bid have not yet attained finality. Ina Reformina, ABS-CBN News.
The political party of presidential aspirant Ferdinand Marcos Jr. wants poll commissioner Rowena Guanzon disbarred and her retirement benefits forfeited. Partido Federal ng Pilipinas General Counsel Attorney George Briones slams Guanzon for what he described as the illegal leaking of her decision on the Marcos disqualification cases. He points out no decision has been promulgated yet by the COMELEC First Division. Briones also called out Guanzon for implying that a politician intervened in the case, saying it's double hearsay. He calls on the COMELEC on bank to conduct an administrative investigation on Guanzon. But Guanzon is unfazed. She challenges Briones to engage her in a debate on TV. Guanzon maintains she's standing for transparency, the truth, and timely government service for all Filipinos. One of the petitioners seeking to stop Marcos's presidential bid, alarmed over alleged interference in the poll body's resolution on the disqualification cases. Akbayan Party List asserts COMELEC Commissioner Guanzon's vote should be counted despite attempts to delay a decision until she retires.
We are with her in the call na dapat bilisan yung pagdidesisyon at pangalawa, dapat bilangin yung boto ni Commissioner Guanzon kasi bahagi ng due process at pagrespeto sa prosesong pinagdaanan namin bilang mga petitioners tulad ng Akbayan at kahit mismo yung kapwa ni Ginoong Marcos. We appeal to not just the ponente but the other members of the Second Division to hear their conscience and use Commissioner Guanzon's vote as both a motivation and a guide in deciding in favor of the truth and a fair electoral system. Siguro yung paalala lang natin sa lahat ay huwag na po tayong magpabudol kay Marcos Jr.
For Howard Calieja, a lawyer for the petitioners in one of the cases, while they salute Commissioner Guanzon's honesty, they are saddened by her revelations. Calieja adds he would still like to trust the neutrality of the poll body, hoping it would uphold its mandate of conducting an honest and truthful elections. The campaign against the return of the Marcoses and martial law, meanwhile, wants Commissioner Guanzon to identify those who are meddling in the case. It also calls on the other poll commissioners handling the matter to decide for truth, justice, and integrity. Just a few months ago, we spoke to former chief presidential, moments ago, we spoke to former chief presidential legal counsel Salvador Senator Panelo. He denied speculations Malacanang was dipping its hand in the cases. Panelo also said the alleged interference of an influential politician is alarming, as he called on the COMELEC to resolve the cases immediately. A Filipino-American attorney general in California spearheads a campaign to stamp out human trafficking in the area, especially during major sports events. Steve Angeles reports.
With the Super Bowl heading to Los Angeles, California's film attorney general Rob Bonta is teaming up with local leaders and the anti-human trafficking group It's a Penalty to tackle human and sex trafficking. According to advocate groups, major sports weekends see spikes in trafficking and prostitution.
Well, this is a time to celebrate. It is also a time to recognize the unfortunate byproduct of being a tourism destination. Today we are here to discuss something that's more important than sports and even the Super Bowl, unfortunately.
There's often a misconception that human trafficking doesn't require There's often a misconception that human trafficking requires movement across borders, but it does not. Human trafficking doesn't require movement across borders, and much of the human trafficking that we see is within the borders of our state of California and the United States. Trafficking at its core is about using fraud or force or coercion, as was mentioned in the video, to exploit someone for labor or for sex.
When they return home.
Under this collaboration, local and state officials, business leaders, advocates, and the NFL have teamed up to launch a campaign calling on the public to raise awareness and report any possible cases of trafficking through signage, PSAs, and public awareness, especially at places like airports. Since taking office, Bonta has implemented a number of programs to combat trafficking while assisting victims.
We've already announced a number of successful disruptions. And dismantlings of human trafficking rings, and providing protection and services and healing to our survivors and victims. So we are very active in this space, and it's because in large part due to the not just the ongoing work that we've been doing, but the increased priority and the focus.
Human trafficking may not be the only concern for Californians. The Super Bowl comes at a time that crime sprees are taking place throughout the state.
Bonta explains that he has a number of initiatives to keep residents safe despite the reports of increased property crimes.
Work in collaboration with our law enforcement partners across the state to address the most pressing issues of public health and public safety of the day. Obviously in the middle of an international pandemic still, so we need to make sure that we're following the guidelines to be safe and healthy. But also, you know, we're very cognizant of and focused on some of the increases in some crimes in some locations, making sure that we're doing everything possible to prevent them from happening in the first place. And certainly if they're occurring, when they're occurring, holding folks accountable, prosecuting, working with our law enforcement partners to make arrests.
Sport brings people. The Super Bowl will take place at the newly opened SoFi Arena on February 13th and is expected to bring large crowds and a number of events in the weeks leading to the big game. But these freedom fighters are hoping that the message to end modern-day slavery can last for the long run. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Los Angeles.
In sports, NBA greats LeBron James and Kevin Durant will go at it again, this time as captains of this year's All-Star Game. For the fifth straight year since the new format was implemented, LeBron once again got the most votes in the Western Conference. Because of that, he'll get to pick who he wants to play with among the All-Star pool, regardless of conference. The Western starter pool includes two-time MVP Steph Curry, last year's MVP Nikola Jokic, and first-time All-Stars Ja Morant and Andrew Wiggins. The East starter pool includes team captain Durant, two-time MVP Giannis Antetokounmpo, Joel Embiid, Trae Young, and DeMar DeRozan. The Philippine branch of the Swedish furniture chain IKEA appeals for patience as it struggles to restock inventory amid the COVID-19 pandemic. In a statement, IKEA Philippines assured its doing its best to improve the situation. IKEA said it has been hit with disruptions caused by the pandemic, citing global shortage of shipping containers and congested seaports. Opened last November, the Philippine branch of IKEA is the Swedish furniture maker's largest outlet at 65,000 square meters. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cband.com. And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify. I'm sorry, Playback to Snoozecast on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on the News Channel.
Isang buwan matapos manalanta ang bagyong